But it's my experience that they are very rarely given the opportunity to seek out therapy, which we all know is available, and I'm sure we'd like to see more of that in the clinics. And I hope that many of you in this audience are having your brains just swirl around and seeing all kinds of exciting things that can be cross-laminated between CF research and voice research. I think there are lots of opportunities for research, and I hope that someone will pick up the torch and put something out there, because as you said, you found one study. I've never seen anything other than my own research, so I think it's really exciting, and thank you for coming.
So the it's interesting. My observation has been that our patients here, when they have a lung transplant, their voice changes completely. You know, and I've always been fascinated. And it's actually different than the change in voice that we see in patients we have seen our guys. And now I'm wondering whether there is a difference in the mucus or the pH, or that might be changing their voice. And if somebody's interested in pushing that out, we'd like to give some ideas of what to do.
Have you noticed any difference in pulmonary function associated with those minor pH changes?
So we're doing those studies now. We're aerosolizing bicarbonate to patients with CF and seeing what happens to them. But again, we haven't. Until now, I haven't thought of looking at the voice, but if somebody has an idea of what are the minor changes in the viscosity of the mucus of the vocal cords would do to the voice, it would be interesting.
I'm sure many of us have thought of a long list of fascinating implications, but among the most simplistic and obvious, I think, is that all of us treat a lot of patients with laryngopharyngeal reflux. It's a very common problem in voice users. It's associated, among other things, with chronic cough. It's also associated with most people would agree an increased predilection to chest infections when people get sick. And we've had lots of explanations for it, all anecdotal, and I'm not sure that anybody has thought of anything as simple as the fact that if you aspirate acid into the airway, you alter the pH of the airway, which might provide an avenue for treatment. One of the things that exists that is not reported yet, Jamie Kaufman, in another off-the-wall concept that will probably turn out to be correct, has been treating many of her laryngopharyngeal reflux patients with aerosolized alkaline water. And she has shown preliminary unpublished data, very interesting changes that have eliminated the erythema of the larynx just by having people walk around with a little aerosol squeeze bottle with a pH of 11. But nobody has looked at what it's done with the lungs. We have recently studied pulmonary function abnormalities because we assess PFTs routinely in all our voice patients. And there's an unexpected incidence of decreased mid flows. A lot of those patients have reflux, but we've never looked at them again after treatment because we've always thought it was pulmonary disease, but maybe it's something simpler than that. So thanks for the ideas. My fellows are going to be very busy for the next couple of years. Dingo?
Yeah, you've created beautiful biological models of CF. Have you given any thought to creating more of a biomechanical model with computer simulation? You know, we have the instrumentation now to measure all the rheological properties of airways, then can embed those into simulators in order to see what it does to voice production. We pitched this to Mike Welsh some years ago, but I'm not sure either one of us were aggressive enough to continue with it. What are your ideas?
So David Stoltz, who is one of the junior faculty in our group, has been working with Qin Long Lin, who is a hydraulic engineer in developing models of particle deposition in the airways of patients with CF, and has done really nice work on modeling the airways, but nobody has done what you were proposing, so when we come back to Iowa, I'd love to talk to you.
Okay. Yeah, thanks.
One last very short question, please.
I'm Georgia, talking to Dr. Zadner. My name is Preeti Shivshankar. I'm from Purdue University. And in the last 10 years, we've been doing a lot of work characterizing epithelial ion transport in the vocal folds. And some of our recent research, we have a pig model that we can get to reflux. And we've been looking at bicarbonate treatments. We haven't been able to do any acoustic recordings of pig vocalizations yet, but we are trying. We're trying to behaviorally condition them to vocalize and see how that changes. But we have actually shown that the vocal folds secrete bicarbonate and that it can be affected in certain conditions when the pH changes. So there is some emerging work on vocal folds and how they transport ions to modulate their environment. So I'd love to talk with you further. Thanks.
Well, Dr. Zadner, thank you very much for a very provocative and interesting and the podium is yours.
So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So we're about to start the afternoon basic science session. And it's sort of split between two topics. One is on hydration.